Welcome, everyone. Thank you for being there today to participate at our 16th webinar about how to finance your international business activities. I will moderate the webinar today. I'm Sophie Dammer, responsible for North American market in the international department at Hub Brussels. This webinar will explain you how to finance your activity, how to anticipate and optimize your financing needs when you think about international your activity. Different financing solution mechanism, their advantages and drawbacks will be explained by our speaker of today, Nicolas Hindencliffe from Echo Business, who is also mainly working for BEI Group. Nicolas Hindencliffe is involved in financing of companies and financial institutions in emerging markets for almost 20 years. So he has a long and large experience in the field. After having been through banking and official institution experience in the field of global management, trade finance, project finance, official institutions, and so on, he has a large experience in the market and will explain you the money market, treasury management, and he will share with you his experience. Nicolas is also advising and supporting other companies in the financing of their import and export activities and the financing of their development and investment in new markets. This webinar will be split in three parts. Sorry, the first one will handle the questions about how to import and export your goods or services when you want to do that from Belgium. The second topic will address questions about new suppliers. So when you want to work with new suppliers outside Belgium, it can be in European Union or outside, you will have to pay attention to new things. So you will receive some tips about that today. And the third part will be more focused on attention point you have to keep in mind when you want to international and establish a presence outside. So that will be the three main topics that you will see, you will hear about today. So I give now the floor to our speaker, Nicolas Hindencliffe. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sophie. And thank you very much to you, Sophie and Thomas, for letting me the opportunity to talk to you today. And thank you also to all the attendees. I know these are difficult moments, and I hope that you all you are all well, at least in a good health. So today I wanted to talk to you about the financing of your activities internationally. And I believe, Sophie, we have maybe first first sondage, a first poll to do together. Yep, I see it. So first of all, let me present myself. So indeed, as explained by Sophie, I have an experience in the development of companies in emerging markets. I am a former banker. I've been active in a lot of different activities on international banking facilities mainly, and I'm also very interested, and I've worked a lot in Africa. Nowadays, I mean, these are difficult circumstances, of course. You know about the COVID, about what we experience every day. And of course, with these circumstances, what you see is the apparition of new products, new markets, also because of the Chinese situation beginning of 2020, different ways of supplying goods, of purchasing goods, where we believe that there will be a reorganization of the supply of goods, not only coming from China, because it was the main focus the last 10 years. And so most probably your international business will change in the coming months and years. Also, what we see major changes with COVID-19 and lockdowns, the push on e-trade, maybe a focus as well on local productions everywhere in the world. Will there be a decrease in demand because of an economic crisis? We don't know yet. And so maybe a need for you as well to develop the international business to make sure that you are still sustainable. Again, we know Belgium. We know all the difficulties that we have at the moment with all lockdowns, with the constraints, with what we cannot do at the moment in Belgium, and the difficulties to develop the business at the moment in Belgium. But in general, in the world, clearly the political environment is very volatile, and we don't know yet, I mean, the economical consequences of the COVID in all these markets. We see, for instance, that emerging markets like maybe Africa as well are quite tough, I mean, quite resilient, maybe because they have also experienced other difficult situations in the past, like Ebola, for instance. But it's difficult to predict actually what will be the exact situation in the coming months, in the coming years, because there are not that much statistics in certain markets. So it's difficult to predict. What we see as well in other business, in other markets, is clearly you don't have the same stakeholders, the same financial institutions, the same insurances, the same partners that you could use in developed countries like Belgium. And especially when it comes to finance your working capital and your assets and your treasury lines. And also when you go to new markets, everything is brand new. It's a new legal environment. It's a new tax environment. You have different constraints. You cannot maybe do leasing in some countries, while in other countries it's very developed. Customs are different as well. So really new markets, new constraints. And when you work with new clients and new suppliers abroad, of course, it's different than in Belgium, where everything can be developed, especially in terms of supply chain, on time. Clearly, when you go with new clients abroad, I mean, you need to discuss about new logistics, new supply chain, and therefore also new payment terms, because no one wants to pay until it is delivered, of course. And it's the same with your suppliers as well. You want to make sure that you will be delivered before paying. Also, I mean, it's very uncertain in the coming months as well about the COVID-19. Will there be waves again, new waves after the third wave that we experiment now? Will there be other waves in the coming months and years? So net not yet very clear, and that's why you need also to make sure that you have well prepared, I mean, the financing of your activities and the risk mitigation of your international activities. So when I want to talk to you about expanding your international activities, I wanted to focus on mainly three topics. First of all, you expand your activities because you have new clients. Although you are still based in Belgium, you will export to new clients elsewhere in the world. So we will see together, I mean, the attention point, what you need to take care of, what could possibly be the challenges of doing that, and how you can mitigate your risk and as well finance this business. Second topic, you are still in Belgium, but because of a change, I mean, possibly you don't have the same supply out of China, for instance, and you change the suppliers to make sure that there is a continuity in the supply chain for you, maybe you will have new suppliers elsewhere than in Belgium. And also you need to find a way to make sure that the performance will be executed and that when you pay, I mean, there is a continuity of supply, that the goods will be the right goods. And that ultimately, I mean, you mitigate all your risk, and your supplier is still in a capacity to supply for long term. Third subject is actually when you don't stay in Belgium anymore, and you need to establish yourself elsewhere. And possibly, I mean, to add value to what you sell, you would need to be present in these new markets, like to provide services after sales on what you sell, because you have a project, you need to build something elsewhere. And more, when you work on an international basis, you need to be locally present because of the tax environment in these countries where there is a clear need more and more with local governments for local presence, for a local establishment. And clearly, selling out of Belgium or being established in another country is completely different in terms of taxes, in terms of financing, a lot of different things. And I will go through key attention points that you need to keep in mind when you do that. Even though, I mean, when you talk about establishing yourselves in another country, I will give you a global overview. But of course, you need to look at each and every market differently, specifically. And I cannot go through each and every market, of course, in this presentation. I will give you more global advices. If it's okay for you, I will start with the client, with new clients purchasing to your Belgian company. So when you do actually import, export out of Belgium, and you produce in Belgium, maybe you have a factory or so on, or you just distribute a brand which is coming from Belgium or from elsewhere, and you just distribute to other clients elsewhere in the world. Clearly, what you will challenge are new clients, maybe with a different credit profile than the ones that you can find in Belgium. Maybe, I mean, not that strong in terms of financial figures, maybe smaller, maybe in countries where the situation is not easy in terms of political risk. If you sell to Africa, it's different than if you sell to the Netherlands, of course. And you need to take this into account. And of course, when you sell offshore, abroad, of course, your clients, they will request to pay you. Most probably, what they will request is to pay you at delivery, while in between your sale and the delivery, there are logistics. And if you sell, I mean, in a landlocked country, in South America, for instance, of course, it takes time to send these goods or these items there, and then waiting for the payment to happen when it's delivered. So you need to find a way to secure these sales because of the different types of clients, size of clients, environment and countries where they are based. You need to be able to finance your sales, the logistics of these sales, and to make sure that your clients will be happy with the payment terms that you offer to them. And you need also to find a way to push your business, increase your business. And the best way to do that is also to use the banking and financial instruments to provide financing to your client. Additional financing above the normal logistic financing is also to be in a position to give a way to the client to finance what he's purchasing. And it's very, very it's very useful. It's a very powerful marketing tool to be in a position to package your offer and not only offer the goods, the items, the equipment, but also give to the client a way to finance it. And clearly, there is a way to use banking facilities as well to do so. So I go back to the three main objectives of the financing of the import export. So first of all, secure your sales. What you want to achieve when you secure your sales, you want to make sure that at the end of the day, even though the client is in a difficult country, even though the client is a small company, you will be paid for the performance that you have executed. For every good that is shipped, you lose, I mean, the property of the good, because it's transported by a transporter with bill of lading and so on. So you want to make sure that from the very first moment where you you leave and you transfer the property of the goods to your client, you want to make sure that you will be paid eventually, even if it's not immediately, that eventually when the client is delivered, you will be paid. Different solutions with banks to achieve that. And not only with banks, you can have a credit insurance, you can use letter of credits or SBLC or other lines draft. I will go further more into details on these tools, of course. Second topic, second objective, how you finance your activities, or you will finance the delay between the moment of where you execute, you perform the agreement, the contractual agreement with your client. So for instance, you ship, and the moment the client is paying. If it takes 3 months to be delivered in Bolivia, for instance, while it's shipped from the very first day, you need to find a way ultimately to get paid from the very beginning, because on your side, you cannot wait for the delivery to get paid. You need to pay your suppliers, you need to make sure that you finance your working capital, in which is included, of course, the cost of supply chain and the financing of the supply chain. A good way to do that is actually the factoring or the receivable finance, meaning the financing of the invoice on the client. And therefore to provide payment terms to your clients to finance the logistics. Third objective, how to boost your business, how to go one step further and package your offer, provide added value in terms of financing to your client and say to your client, okay, you would like to purchase to me these goods because you will sell on in your market, and maybe in your market you need a stock to sell to your clients. Maybe in your market as well, you won't be in a position to collect the payment from your clients immediately as well. So maybe you need an additional deferred payment to boost the business of your clients and therefore boost your own business and making sure that you increase your turnover to clients. Multiple solutions to do that, buyer's credit with the use of banks and export credit agencies. You can also put in place an in-house financing solution for your clients, or you can as well use the same factoring but extend the payment terms and find a way to at the same time ensure these payment terms and also finance these payment terms. If I go back now to the first risk mitigation objective, which is to secure your sales. First solution, the credit insurance. The credit insurance, maybe you know them, Credendo, Atradius, these are names maybe you already know. What is the objective of the credit insurance? Is to provide you with a solution for which you pay a premium, of course, and the objective of the credit insurance is to mitigate the risk, so to make sure that ultimately you will cover yourself against all order being cancelled from your clients, where you have, for instance, already ordered to your suppliers, or you have already started the production, and ultimately the client is not purchasing anymore, and you want to make sure that all your existing cost will be already covered in case of cancelling. And secondly, you need the credit insurance to make sure to cover at the moment you invoice. So for instance, you have shipped, you have invoiced to your clients to pay you at 90 days. Then you want to make sure that from the very first day of your invoice, if the client is not paying ultimately after 90 days, you will be insured and you will be indemnified by your credit insurance of a certain value of the invoice. Most of the time, I mean, you receive a cover up to 90%. It's usually the case with Credendo, with Atradius, with institutions based in Europe. But elsewhere in the world, and in London with Lloyds, you can even find credit insurance up to 100%, which is, at the end of the day, covering the cost of purchase to your suppliers, but also your margin. it is a very powerful instrument, the credit insurance, because of course it gives you a certain comfort that you will get paid ultimately. If you are not paid, you will be indemnified. But it's also a good tool to make sure that ultimately you will be in a position to finance your business. And I will go back in the second objective of financing the supply chain and financing your sales. You will see that credit insurance is very important as well. So most of the time, when I talk about my personal experience, I have been involved in the sales of equipment in Africa to a lot of different clients and countries. And actually, to be honest with you, I have had very, very few defaults. So the sinistrality is close to zero for the last 15 years of business that I'm doing with these clients in Africa. They always pay late, but they always pay. But at the end of the day, I have put a credit insurance for the whole company in place, mainly to make sure that ultimately I will be in a position to finance these sales. So when you talk about that with bankers, when you talk about that with other, with even with clients, most of the time the first reaction is to say, okay, you don't trust me. That's why you put in place a credit insurance, because you believe that ultimately I will not be in a position to pay. And you have these discussions, of course, with your clients, because you want to tell them that you will insure the business and to make sure they are insured. Sometimes you need to share information about these lines with your credit insurance. So you need to be transparent with your clients. But my answer most of the time to these clients is to say, no, I don't do that because I don't trust you. I do that only because it's a powerful tool to finance what I give to you and to be in a position to give you extended payment terms and making sure that at the end of the day, I'm still sustainable. Also, what you can do with this credit insurance, I'm talking about short-term revolving business here. I'm not talking about buyer's credit. I will talk about that at the later stage. Here, we are talking about mainly revolving up to 180 days payment terms to clients. So there you use credit insurance. Another way to secure your sales is to use letter of credits. I don't know if you are all familiar with letter of credits. If you have questions about that, I can go more into details about the mechanism. But just to keep in mind on your side, we use letter of credits mainly for punctual sales. When you have revolving small sales of goods, you don't use it. Why? Because, I mean, you have forfeit cost to put it in place. There is documentation to put in place to do that, and an exchange of documents with your banks and the bank of your client. So it is quite time consuming as well. And all these banking costs, I mean, they are not really worth doing it if it's below a punctual sale of, say, 50,000 euro. I would say above that, it makes sense to use an LC. Below that, you should use SBLC, standby letter of credit, or credit insurance, which is the best way to secure revolving sales. So the principle of the LC is that when the client is purchasing to you and when the bank of your client is issuing an LC and it is confirmed by your bank, you can be sure that whatever is happening to your client or the country of your client, you will be paid if you execute the performance. So you, for instance, if the terms of the letter of credits are that you will be paid upon shipping, when you will present the documents of shipping to your bank, you will in any case be paid. And the difference between letter of credit and credit insurance is that it's not 90%, you will be paid 100% for sure. Of course, when you do that, you need to make sure that the client, the bank of the client is acceptable for your bankers. You need to make sure that all the costs have been included in the structure of the price, because you will have on your side confirmation cost. if there is a deferred payment in DLC, you will have discount cost as well. So clearly, you need, before doing a transaction with the client under an LC structure, you need to talk to your bank, you need to make sure about the bank of your client, and you need to recalculate everything, because sometimes it might increase the price up to 3, 4, 5%. So it's important to make sure in advance that it was well budgeted. Another good thing for your client as well is that when he will issue an LC with certain terms, for instance, that you as a supplier, your company will only be paid when they ship, the client, your client can be sure that if you don't ship, you will not be paid. So for your client, it's also very important to use this mechanism, because it will be sure then that you will execute the performance. Otherwise, there will be no obligation for him to pay. So most of the time, we only see the benefits for the beneficiary of DLC for yourselves, but it's also something very important to explain to your client. If, for instance, it's a new business relationship, we don't know each other. I mean, you don't know him, you don't know if you will be paid. That's why you put an LC in place, but they don't know you. They don't know if you perform correctly, if it will be executed in the right way, in the right delay. And of course, in the letter of credit, there is a delay to execute the performance. So clearly, also the client, the issuer of the LC, the applicant of the LC, is protected against that as well. SBLC, it's a different mechanism. Maybe you will hear about that. It's like an LC, except that we don't share documents. It's like a guarantee of payment. So sometimes it is used to replace credit insurance for revolving small sales with same clients, where if you reach a certain outstanding of sales, it might be secured by a payment guarantee. Good thing as well to use DLC is that you can provide to your clients a delay in payment up to 180 days, even more than that, meaning that DLC can be paid at the presentation of the bill of lading plus, for instance, 6 months, which means that you on your side, when you receive this LC and when it's confirmed by your bank, and when you present your documents of shipping to your bank, you can say to your bank, please discount, so pay me already these 6 months. So I receive as a supplier, you will receive immediately the money, while your client will only have to pay 180 days later, 6 months later. And it's only due to the fact that the issuing bank, so the bank of your client, was able to issue an LC with 6 months additional to the presentation of documents. So it's also a very good way to provide payment terms to your clients, very secured. Of course, when we talk about letter of credit, if you are familiar with that, I mean, make sure that the wording is right, that you can execute what is mentioned in the LC. That ultimately you don't create discrepancies. If you say in the LC that the latest date of shipping is in 3 months, make sure that you can execute the shipping within 3 months. Otherwise, if you don't comply with the LC, actually it's like if nothing is covered. It's like if there is no LC at all, and then you are 100% at risk. So it's very important to take care about the wording and making sure that your client and yourselves are okay with the wording of the LC. Second subject, how to finance your activities when you sell to your clients. So how to finance the supply chain, how to finance the logistics. And of course, the first answer is if the client is requesting to pay at delivery, what you will say to your client is no. What I offer to you is you pay at shipping, but I give you a deferred payment, a delay to pay me. meaning, for instance, instead of invoicing you only when you are delivered locally, I will invoice you at the very first day of the shipping, and I give you, if it takes 3 months to go to South Africa, then I give you 90 days of deferred payment, or 120 days deferred payment, so that you pay only when normally the goods will be delivered to you. By doing that, and if for difficult countries, difficult clients, you credit insured, so you put in place a credit insurance on these invoices, you can liaise with the bank, and you can have an agreement with the bank to factor, meaning to discount the invoice from the very first day the invoice is issued. Yes?
Nicolas, excuse me to interrupt you. Maybe it's better to answer to the question that we got in the chat box. Okay. About the
Sorry,
first part.
Sorry, I don't
part.
See the question.
Yeah, that's why I'm there. So okay. If I can maybe tell you the questions. There is a question about the ELC. Someone would like to know a bit more about ELC, the Irrevocable Letter of Credit, and he would like to know the difference between a full payment in advance and ELC. And then we have a second question.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So most of the time you hear about ELC or simply LC. Just for you to know that in the general international trade today, we don't talk anymore about revocable LC. So all LCs in the world are irrevocable. Why? Because there is no upside, no advantage to receive an LC which can be cancelled. So ultimately, all banks are only putting in place no irrevocable commitment to pay you. And you should be sure, and you have to make sure that this will be the LC you receive, which means that no one, if the LC is confirmed, can ever change something except if you agree. And that's the principle of the irrevocable LC. Compared to a full payment in advance, of course, I didn't mention that in the presentation. If your client is okay to pay you in advance, that's even better. You could say, at the order, when you order, I only accept the order if you pay in advance. That's always preferred. But you don't have any client accepting that. I mean, maybe for the first order or the second order to start building the track record, but more and more in the global world, no one will ever accept anymore to pay in full at order. Maybe you get a down payment at the order, but the rest will be paid upon execution of what you have to do, producing, shipping, and so on. So that's where you need to have mechanisms like credit insurance or letter of credits, which helps you to pay to get paid later on, based on these steps of productions, shippings, logistics, and so on. And for instance, the LC, I mean, it can be paid at shipping, but it can be paid partially at delivery as well, or it can be paid partially at ex work of a factory, and so on.
Thank you, Nicolas.
I answered correctly to the question.
I hope so. Otherwise, please ask more details. We do have another question about reverse factoring. Can you comment a bit more about that, please?
Yes, I will go to this subject later on when I talk about the suppliers. Indeed, okay. I'm talking here about factoring, but there is another mechanism which is reverse factoring, indeed.
Okay, perfect.
So here, no problem. Here, the flow is really between you and your client. You invoice with deferred payment terms, for instance, 30 to 120 days payment terms, and you want to make sure that what you will invoice, you can already collect the money of the invoice from the very first day of the invoice, even though your client will only be obliged to pay later on. That's where you use, for difficult countries, difficult emerging markets, and so on, credit insurance. to ensure the risk of non-payment. And then with the bank, you put in place a structure where the bank will finance each and every invoice. So give you the money upfront and waiting for the client to pay you to reimburse the facility that has been granted to you the very first day. This is the principle of the factoring, but it goes one step further, meaning that if you have a revolving business and if each and every month you present new invoices to your bank in this factoring program, actually what will happen is that the amount that you receive the very first day, if your client pays you at 60 days, for instance, after 60 days, your client is paying and it is reimbursed. So normally the facility is stopped, but each and every month you present new invoices. And if your business is constant, it means that ultimately what you have is a sort of treasury or working capital line, which will be renewed by the presentation of new invoice, while at the same time the previous invoice are getting paid. So that's a very good way of having an ongoing revolving working capital and supply chain financing. And of course, if you go to emerging markets, and that was the experience that I shared with you previously, when you work on emerging markets, you will be able to convince banks to go with yourselves and to put in place such program if you have the credit insurance in place. If you don't have any credit insurance, it's difficult for Belgian bankers to support you with emerging markets clients. And that's where the credit insurance really makes a difference in the working capital financing. I've mentioned here a few banks in Belgium which are able to do these offshore financing facilities. Don't know if there are questions about that.
Doesn't seem to have questions.
The third objective when you want to finance your sales is clearly to boost your sales and using the financing capacities to boost your sales. And when you do that, you give additional payment terms to your clients, not only saying to your client, okay, because it takes 3 months to arrive in South Africa, you will only pay me in 3 months. But to say to your client, okay, you need to put a stock locally to increase your sales. You need you as well to give payment terms to your clients. We can do so. And not only give you 3 months, but giving you 1 year, 2 years, 3 years financing. That is possible as well. And it gives a real added value to your offer. I'm talking about clients that are selling, but it's the same if your client needs an equipment to run a business. If your client is looking for a machine, most probably the machine will be amortized and having a return on the investment on a few years as well. So if you provide to him delayed payment up to 1, 2, 3 years, it's also a good way for him to invest and purchase to you. So clearly what we see now is it is so difficult, and especially in emerging market, to get financed, that when you, as a supplier, you are in a position to provide a package, including the financing, it's a very powerful competitive advantage. And sometimes even when you are in a position to do that, the profitability of these emerging market is so high for them that if you are in a position to provide this financing, we don't even talk anymore about the price of the goods, because it's clearly accelerating the business of your clients. What you see more and more is that also doing that from offshore, you are in a position to provide cheap funding to emerging markets clients. You can package it with other things as well, because if you are providing financing to a client, you can then lock other conditions as well. And you can say to your client, if I finance you, then I want to make sure that you sign with me an after sales contract. I want to make sure that you will purchase the spare parts, or you will commit yourselves on a certain level of purchases as well. So it's a good way as well to boost and increase the level of business by doing so. We see, of course, more and more clients, even in emerging markets, looking for added value for package offers. I mean, 20 years ago, I mean, it was possible to do trading in offshore markets in emerging markets. It's not the case anymore. More and more clients are looking for suppliers which will provide training, which will provide support capacities, quick reaction capacities, alongside as well the financing. And in some countries where there are no IFRS rules yet, you may also provide sometimes leasing solutions where for the client it's off balance sheet, which is clearly an advantage for some clients. So I advise you, when you want to push and when you want to develop your international sales, make sure that you have this tool as well in your toolkit, the financing of your client. How to do that? Two main tools. One which is using banks and which is the buyer's credit. Actually, you will sell to your clients with normal payment terms, so short payment terms, but you will contract with a bank, and most of the time an export credit agency, and we have that in Belgium with Credendo, so that the bank is actually financing your client on a long-term basis. Up to 7 years, we have banks doing that in Belgium, depending, of course, on the rationale of the project or on the rationale of the sale, of course. But you can put structure where your client will be financed with your bankers. And we have excellent banks doing that in Belgium and even in Europe. I mean, you are not obliged to use Belgian bankers to do that. But of course, as a Belgian company, you have an advantage is to have Credendo. And Credendo has a strong appetite, especially on emerging markets. So it's very powerful. And in Belgium, there is really a way to do that. Another solution is to provide to your client what looks like an in-house solution from yourself. It's like if you say to your client, OK, I will be the banker and I will provide you with the financing. How does it work? Actually, instead of having a financing from a bank directly to your client, it's yourself which is saying to your client, OK, there is a down payment to confirm the order, but then you will pay me, for instance, with quarterly repayment over 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. And you don't have to take care about anything. It's just that you have to comply and pay on the due date of each long-term payment terms. And what you will do on your side, you will use these long-term receivables, which most of the time will be materialized into bill of exchange or drafts, what we call in French détraite, and you will insure these commercial papers with credit insurance, and you will sell these commercial papers to your bank, which will discount these receivables to your company. And of course, for the client, for your client, it's like if your company was providing the financing. He doesn't have to go to any bank. For him, it's a diversification of its funding because he's not using the local bankers and neither the international bankers. And you can even package it. I mean, if you are saying to your client, okay, you will pay me in 2 years' time every quarter. I mean, of course, when you will discount this commercial paper to your bank, there will be a cost. But somehow you can include it in a package, including after sales, including a lot of things, and provide offers which are synthetically 0% financing, while you know that there is a cost of financing, but you try to market it like if it was an effort. And it's very powerful to do that. It's clearly a good way to push your business. And when you provide the financing, then you can sell other things as well, because there is an in-depth and a relationship with your clients. Of course. So these are really good ways to boost your business. What you can do as well is to find a way to have an extended factoring. I mean, the same factoring I was mentioning in the previous slide, where actually your bankers and your credit insurance would agree to go up to 360 days, up to 1.5 year or so on. That is also possible on revolving business. I will talk now about the suppliers. I don't know if there were questions regarding financing your sales to your clients. Okay. So I've talked about the sales side when you sell to your clients. No, because of changes in the supply chains in the world in general, maybe we won't rely too much anymore on China because of what happened with the lockdowns in China beginning of 2020. We'll be looking for other sources of supply. So most probably you will, in the coming months and years, working with new suppliers. And working with new suppliers means that you will not know them and they will not know you. And you have to start building a relationship, a traffic art of collaboration. But at the same time, how can you be sure that when you order, and most probably you pay a down payment to your supplier, or is requesting an upfront full payment in advance, how can you be sure that he will execute his performance? How can you be sure about his financial strength? Is he sufficiently good and big to execute the order that you have passed? Will he survive? If, for instance, your supplier is based in a difficult country in Africa, how can you be sure that nothing will happen there? And ultimately that you have already paid, but you are not supplied at the end of the day. How to convince as well, at the same time, new suppliers to work with you. And that ultimately, if they agree to start producing, that you will pay them when they will perform. Exactly the same way, you want to make sure that your client will pay you when you will have performed. And at the same time, how to work as well in increasing these payment terms with your suppliers so that it gives you more time to pay them and therefore more working capital in order to grow your business. And that's where I will talk as well about the reverse factoring that you were mentioning, Sophie. So coming back to the main objectives of finding solutions to finance the supplier side, first of all, risk mitigation. How to make sure that even though my supplier is small, even though he's newly established or he's in a different country, a difficult country, an emerging market, how can I be sure that I will get the supply that I will get, that what I paid for will be executed? Good solution is the letter of credit. And in this case, not anymore an export letter of credit where you will ask for a confirmation, but that's where you will issue a letter of credit yourself. Second objective is how to convince new suppliers. Maybe the first question of a new supplier when talking to you will be, okay, provide me with your latest financials. Are you sufficiently big so that I can be sure that when I will start producing, you will pay me? And sometimes it's not that easy to start a commercial relationship with suppliers. For instance, if you are a newly created company, if you have a new business and you don't have yet the track record or the financial figures. So there are ways to start this relationship, commercial relationship, using banking solutions and also credit insurance, like, of course, the import letter of credits, but also collaborate with the credit insurance of your supplier. Third objective is, how can I get deferred payment terms? Is there a possibility for me to pay later on my supplier so that if I need to give also payment terms to my clients, it's a sort of back-to-back. I won't have to pay my supplier earlier than the moment I get paid by my client, or maybe I have a production time. So before being in a position to invoice my client and collect the money from my client, I want to have a bit of time before paying my suppliers. So that's where I need to have a deferred payment from my supplier. And of course, if the supplier doesn't know you, or if it's a starting relationship, it's difficult to obtain this from the very beginning. So that's where you need as well to use banks with deferred payment terms, LC, factoring or reverse factoring. First topic of the supplier side, risk mitigation. And the best way to do that is the import LC. It's where you, as a purchaser to your supplier, will request your bank to issue an LC so that your supplier will ask his banker to confirm the LC. And by doing so, and taking into account, of course, the wording of the LC, you can be sure that your supplier will not be paid if he's not executing the performance according to the terms of the LC. If you say in the LC that the shipping must happen in the next 3 months, you can be sure that it will happen in the next 3 months. Why? Because if the supplier isn't able to do so, he will produce, maybe ship too late, and will not be sure to get paid. And then you will still be in a position to renegotiate the terms because the LC will not be valid anymore. You will be, for instance, able to negotiate about penalties, about discounts and so on, because the execution was not according to what was agreed from the very beginning. So I believe you should keep this in mind. LC are not only for clients, most of the time as well, it could be a very useful tool for your suppliers. And especially when we go to the second topic, which is convincing your suppliers, by doing that with an import letter of credit, your supplier, even though you are a small company, even though he doesn't know you, he will also be sure that ultimately he will get paid. So if you are in a position to convince your bankers in Belgium to issue these LCs, even if it's for an exceptional order, if it's for a big order, your supplier may agree to do it, because he will have sufficient comfort to make sure that he will be paid ultimately. So it's a good way to secure the business. At the same time, when advising companies to improve their relationship with suppliers, most of the time when I do that in my job, I'm advising local companies in Africa. And I explain to them, okay, if you want to purchase to suppliers and improve the way you get new suppliers, you have access to new products, clearly take into account your capacity to issue LCs, but also take into account the way you could be credit insured. The way the credit insurance of your suppliers could cover the invoice of your suppliers to you. And how to do that is, of course, to provide as much as possible formal and structured information to credit insurance in general. So what I advise to clients purchasing, I say to them, please structure your group, provide all information regarding the shareholders, make sure that your financial statements are audited, make sure that you are very transparent in the way you communicate with stakeholders, and be open to communicate with your suppliers' credit insurances. For instance, I have a client which is working with a Swedish supplier. Well, we are very normal for us then to prepare quarterly meetings with EKN, which is the Swedish public credit insurance, Swedish ECA. And even though the supplier want to manage the relationship, and of course we let him manage the relationship. By doing so, we help EKN to increase its appetite on yourself, on the client, on the purchasing company. And by doing so, and having a bigger appetite, there is of course a bigger line for your supplier. And then your supplier is in a position to secure more sales and potentially to give you more extended deferred payment terms as well. So really, in this world, my advice is not only discussing with your bankers or your credit insurance, be prepared also to discuss with your suppliers' credit insurance, with other stakeholders, and be very transparent about your business. Clearly, when you do that, you increase your capacities of working with new suppliers, making sure they can accept big order or exceptional orders, and getting deferred payment terms from them. And that's where I come on the third point, is how to obtain these extended payment terms from your supplier. And clearly, three situations. If your supplier is okay with LCs and you are in a position to issue LCs, you should do that. You should issue LCs with your bank, and then request your supplier will request its banker to confirm the LC. But the LC could be paid at site, but the LC could be paid also exactly the same way I was talking about financing, sales, and clients. The LC could be at 180 days, could be at 36 days, 360 days. Meaning that if you put this deferred payment in the LC, you, as a purchaser, you will be, for instance, able to pay only after 6 months or 1 year, which gives you a certain time to produce or to sell before being obliged to pay your suppliers. And at the same time, your supplier will be able, at the moment the LC is confirmed and when he will present the document to its bank, to discount the LC and obtain immediately on his side the money. And it's the bank which will actually bear the financing during this deferred payment term, deferred payment period. Of course, the discount is not free. I mean, you need to discuss from the very beginning with your supplier about the structure, about the deferred payment terms, and you will actually include all these costs in the final price, the agreed price of the purchase, of course. But it's a very good way to do that. And to give you an example, we are not talking about only emerging markets. I work for a company which is purchasing machines in Japan and from out of Europe. And you could say, okay, there is no risk for Japanese to work with a Belgian company. But we use that to make stocks. So we were purchasing machines, paid at shipping plus 1 year, meaning that when the machines are arriving actually in Belgium, it's approximately 2 months of logistics, we still have 10 months before paying the Japanese supplier. And during these 10 months, we can have a stock here and boost our sales with a stock of immediate availability of machines. While the Japanese, when they present the document of shipping to their banker, they can request to their banker to be immediately paid, with the cost of discounting, which is agreed in the total price between the company, the Belgian company and Japanese supplier, but fully financed by the bank. So it is very powerful to use that. If your supplier is bigger than yourselves, if the supplier is bigger, what you could do is, again, very transparent discussion and provision of information to the credit insurance of your suppliers, so that your supplier can put in place a factoring exactly the same way you would have put in place the factoring with your clients. I mean, what I have explained earlier in the presentation, your supplier can do that as well, and providing you with deferred payment terms, discounted on his side, while you will pay later on, and secured by your credit insurance. And that's where your communication with your suppliers and your suppliers' credit insurance is very key, because this will be the way to put in place such a program. Third situation, you are bigger than your supplier. And therefore, since you are bigger than your supplier, maybe your supplier is not in a position to put in place a factoring, is not able to discuss with its bankers, and the appetite of its banker is small because it's still a small company. That's where we put what we call a reverse factoring, where you will talk with your bankers as a purchasing company to your suppliers. So we are talking about your banker, and your banker actually will pay your supplier immediately. So your supplier will invoice you with normal short payment terms, and you will reimburse your banks on a deferred duration, meaning that you will only pay maybe after 180 days, but your banker will pay immediately your supplier at the first day of the invoice. And that's what we call a reverse factoring. And also the reverse factoring is possible because these invoices, and possibly also with extended payment terms, are secured by credit insurance. So again, I mean, the main message is be structured, be open to communicate transparently, and use your bankers. I mean, because it will help you to push your stocks, push your working capital, and increase your capacity to grow. This is regarding the supplier side. I don't know if you have questions regarding the supplier side. I'm aware that I go very quickly on a lot of different options, and we can go, if you want, one day more into details. But this is a global view about the relationship with the supplier with regard to financing with banks and credit insurance. Sophie?
I don't see any questions about that topic, so I guess okay. It was clear.
I hope I answered to the reverse factoring topic then. Third situation, when you develop your international activities, is when it's not sufficient anymore to sell out of Belgium. And your clients are requesting added value on site, locally, or because of the local regulations, you're obliged to be locally established. For instance, in Nigeria, you cannot sell shoes from offshore, or it's very limited with huge taxes if you do that. Why? Because they would like to push the shoes production business in Nigeria. So if you want to do that, they will oblige you to be locally established in this country, potentially also to have a factory to somehow produce shoes in Nigeria. So depending on the countries, depending on the added value that you want to put in your business, depending on the tax constraints and so on, sometimes you are obliged to be locally established as well. So create a local subsidiary, what we call succursal or filial, in these other countries elsewhere in the world. Main question, when will you do that? How you finance this local presence? Because you will have fixed cost, of course. Local staff, establishments costs, you will need working capital in any case. You might have stocks, and then you need to finance also these assets that are in other countries than Belgium. And how you will organize and manage the risk of all these flows between your headquarters and your local company. Here, I won't go that much into all potential solutions in terms of financing, of course. Why? Because depending on the countries, I mean, it's different in each country of the world, almost in terms of partners, in terms of sophistication, in terms of tax environment and so on. But I will go back to a few aspects. that you need to keep in mind and the challenges that are happening when you develop your company elsewhere. First of all, if you want to finance your local activities, I would say the daily activities, the working capital of your company, at first, what is normal is to put an equity, to have a capital for the company, which is most of the time the starting of the company, for the establishment cost, for the first staff, before you are in a position to have turnover locally. And most of the time will not only be a capital, will be a first interco loan, a subordinated loan, or so on, to develop your local presence by a support from the main headquarters, because you are not in a position to immediately generate profitability, of course. What you could put in place at the second stage, or already discuss about that with local banks, or local factoring, if you are invoicing local customers, why not doing the same than when you do offshore sales? In provide deferred payment terms to your local clients, and immediately finance from the very first day of the invoice, the invoice itself, which is giving you on a revolving business a working capital facility. Also, what you will need to put in place, especially in emerging markets or markets with customs constraints, you will need to put in place customs bonds, customs guarantees to make sure that you have not to pay upfront all customs and import duties and so on. In some very public markets where a lot of public institutions and public clients are working with yourselves, you might need as well to be in a position to issue bid bonds, performance bond, advance payment bonds, and so on. So you will need also to make sure that you have bankers locally able to do that. And also, you have to make sure that you are in a position to lend to your company, so that when you discuss with your banker at the headquarter level, they are okay with the fact that a number of lines that are put in place by themselves and the treasury that you generate from your activity, you can use it to finance your local presence abroad. And it's not that easy to do that, because your bankers may feel comfortable to finance your Belgian business, but when it comes to invest in a presence in Burkina Faso or in Mali, where the political situation is not that easy, it's not easy to convince your banker to let a part of the financing which is given to your headquarters actually go to these countries in capital, but also in subordinated loans or intercos. So it's a clear discussion that you need to have with your bankers. And my suggestion is really to talk with international bankers, which have, if possible, also presence in the countries where you want to establish, so that you can bank as well at the headquarters locally, and then they will feel more comfortable about what is done locally and the way it is, the headquarters will be reimbursed ultimately about these loans and dividends if the activity is profitable. So look for, when you want to develop internationally, really look for banks which have an international footprint. It's really an asset. Second thing you want to finance locally are assets. Assets which might be premises, a workshop, warehouses, offices, vehicles, tooling, productions, factory, but also stocks. I mean, keep in mind that in Belgium, banks are very sophisticated. You can have stock financing, you can have floor plan financing for distribution. It's not the case in all countries. Same with factoring, which is possible in Belgium. In some countries, the bank regulation is not that sufficiently sophisticated, or there are bank central bank constraints. They are only in a position to finance short term, and you will be in a position if you want to finance stocks for, let's say, 3 years, you will be obliged to finance on a one-year basis and renew these facilities. So you have to take into account that not everything will be possible, and you will have to understand exactly the capacities of your local bankers before investing to make sure that the money you invest will be supported by financing locally as well. Because if you invest and ultimately you understand that there will be no capacities to support your business locally or not in the way it was foreseen, it means that you will be obliged ultimately to either stop the business or put again another financing from the headquarters. And we all know that in some difficult countries, it's not that easy to pay dividends, even to repay loans, to access to international transfers. And you may create big risk of having actually your money elsewhere in different markets because you don't have sufficient capacity locally to be supported. So it's clear, it's very important from the very beginning to understand where you go, the capacity of the banking system locally, and making sure that you will be in a position to be supported. Also take into account that the cost of financing is different in each part of the world. In each country, so you need to also to take into account that a stock financing in DRC is most probably between 12 and 15% per annum, which is completely different than in Belgium. So it may have a huge impact on the business model that you want to develop locally, and maybe then about operational decisions, for instance, servicing in sea or having hubs in countries where it's more possible to stock and finance your stock with cheaper rates. Third topic is how to manage the intercos if you lend money to your company or if you do a business of distribution and you, for instance, sell the goods to your subsidiary, which will then ultimately sell to clients locally. Keep in mind that when you sell to a third-party client, which is not your subsidiary, you can put in place credit insurance. If you sell to your company, your subsidiary, no one will ever support you in terms of credit insurance because it's interco. So you will not mitigate these flows against political risk or credit risk. So if something is happening in Mali with your subsidiary in Mali, and you have huge interco between your headquarters and your subsidiary, maybe you cannot get your money back. Of course, one day, but if the situation is lasting for months, you may have 4 months to wait for your cash. It's a trapped cash then, and it will have an impact on the rest of your activities if this cash was needed to continue your business in Belgium. So keep in mind this, if you are in a country with a different money, like in the French-speaking Africa, it's franc CFA, so this is directly linked to euro. But if it's in a different country in Nigeria, if the trap is cash for months, maybe also you can have forex impact. Devaluation of the local currency and so on, actually leading to losing money. So keep in mind, it's very important to make sure that your intercos are well managed, as small as possible, and with the local financing as big as possible, even though it's expensive, but also to manage the risk. And ultimately, if you are not able to do that, then you can still put in place letter of credit between your subsidiaries and yourself. This is the only way to secure your business of intercos. Financing challenge when you finance internationally, or when, especially when you finance your local subsidiaries. Again, what I said, don't forget that other bankers elsewhere in the world may not have the same sophistication level and maybe not the same credit appetite. Maybe sometimes they will be more keen to finance treasury lines, but maybe not. Maybe they will not be able to do stock finance, for instance, or factoring. So talk to these bankers and make sure that you know which kind of counterparts you have in front of you. Don't forget the potential effect of foreign exchange. If your cash is staying long in your subsidiaries, you may also lose money there just because of the foreign exchange changes. Again, Intercos cannot be covered against political risk. Don't forget the cost of funding, which in emerging markets is more expensive. I mean, most of the time when I discuss in conferences about the fact I'm mainly working with emerging markets, the main reaction is, you work in emerging markets, so you have huge margins. And that's correct. I mean, top of the P&L, we have huge margins. Because in these emerging markets, I mean, you can still price quite expensive to these clients, and you can still have a gross margin, which is quite comfortable. But all the costs below in the P&L, establishment cost, financing cost, the cost of labor is not always less expensive. It's not always the case. But at the end of the day, when I compare European or Belgian activity to an emerging market activity, most of the time, at the end of the day, the net profitability is the same. Just a difference in the way the P&L is structured. You have better gross margin in emerging market, but more fixed cost and financial cost. You have a lower margin in sophisticated market, but of course, the cost of financing is lower as well. The interest, of course, is to be present in both markets, to have a diversification, both mature and emerging markets. But you have to take into account that the gross margin is not everything. Of course, financing in new markets, different tax environment as well, and logistic and custom costs are very important as well. The last thing I wanted to say about the challenge of financing your international activities, sales, new suppliers, or your local establishment in these new markets. Don't forget that before talking to bank, before talking to credit insurance, the first way to find cash for your company is internal. It's in your business. It's by decreasing your cost. It's by improving the terms with the existing suppliers before talking to new suppliers. It's by improving your aging balance. If your clients are paying late, this is easy money. It's by improving your business model. If, for instance, your logistic is not good enough and you take too much time to send these goods to South Africa, it takes 3 months. Maybe if you improve the logistic and you can do it in 2 months, then you can say to your clients, okay, instead of paying me at 90 days, you will pay me now at 60 days. Because you get the goods 30 days earlier than before. And therefore, you create cash by doing that because you are getting paid earlier. So a lot of things internally in the way you work can lead to actually more cash and ultimately decreasing your stocks and inventories. This is clearly trapped cash in your company. If you are able to improve the on-time business, clearly you will find more cash as well to put it in your international activities. So, and your banker, they will appreciate that. They will understand that you are not only asking money to them, but you will find ways as well to find money internally. And more bankers, when they put covenants to your banking facilities, they are looking at that. They are looking at your aging balance. They are looking at what we call DSO, DPO. So your payables with suppliers, your sales with your clients. This is very important. So these are a few advice apart from the presentation on international financing. So I don't know if there are questions, and I hope that I have fulfilled your expectations today. And I talk a lot, sorry, and very quickly because there was a lot to say.
Thank you very much, Nicolas. We don't have any question anymore. So I guess we can conclude here. If you still want to ask questions, we still have 1 minute. So otherwise, I will maybe tell you about the next webinar. Next week, we will organize another one about VAT, linked to export, of course. So I don't see any question. So I guess that I can warmly thank you, Nicolas, for your input. It was really interesting.
Thank you very much. And again, if anyone wants to contact me about one specific subject or has any question one-to-one, I mean, you can share my contact details and it will be in the presentation as well. So don't hesitate.
Yeah, okay, of course. We will share the presentation with everyone so they will have your contact.
Thank you very much. Thank you to everybody.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a nice day.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.